Good morning and welcome to today's webinar, From Disaster Recovery to Business Continuity. Our session is being led by James Raby, Macquarie Telecom's Senior Product Marketing Manager. You will also hear from Dale Wilson, our Product Manager, Hosting and Security, and Alex Newman, Hosting and Cloud Subject Matter Expert. The presentation will take approximately 45 minutes, and you are welcome to use chat throughout the session to ask questions. I will now hand the session over to James.
Thanks, Katrina. Hey, so let's start with talking about what's happened in those recent floods and cyclones in Queensland. Most of us will know that three quarters of the state was declared a disaster zone, and it affected the residents, the tourism, but businesses as well. So speaking of those businesses, one in 10 of them was either partially or fully inundated with water, and one in 5 of them had to close as a result of floods or loss of power. And another 15% of those businesses were impacted by power outages. So far, the businesses that have reported to the government have said that they've been closed on average for 8 days, with a median of about 4 days. And while just over 40% were able to resume normal work within 5 days, and another 12% within 10 days, you know, 45% of businesses needed more than 2 weeks to return to normal operations, with the median being about 10 days. Now, this 10-day figure is significant, as surveys have shown that 10 days without a data center often results in companies filing for bankruptcy. And already, 40% of the Queensland businesses that are reporting the financial impact of the disasters to their business are saying that it's cost them somewhere between $20,000 and $100,000, and another almost quarter reporting lost revenue of up to $500,000. So all this drives home the point that natural disasters do wreak havoc on businesses. Yet it's the more typical events, you know, things like power blackouts from a heat wave, or traffic jams from transport strikes, or special events preventing users from getting to the workplace, can be just as disruptive. And like as I mentioned before, disruptions to data centres can often result in bankruptcy. According to the US National Archives and Records Administration, in general, 93% of companies that lost their data centre for 10 days or more due to a disaster filed for bankruptcy within 1 year of that disaster. Now, half of those businesses found themselves without data management for the same time period filed for bankruptcy almost straight away. Even if bankruptcy is avoided, an outage can have significant negative impact to a business. That inability to process, deliver, or bill orders means that revenue is being lost. And while most customers show some understanding when an outage is due to a major disaster, when it's self-inflicted or otherwise avoidable, many will lose patience and they'll take their business elsewhere. For a lot of IT organisations, that period, initial period after an outage, can be taken up with remedial or preventative work, the sort of things I call shutting the barn door projects. And then putting in a disaster recovery plan to remediate against any of these effects requires a fairly significant investment from IT, because you're effectively duplicating all your mission-critical hardware and software. On top of all the capital that you're investing, maintaining a DR program requires the IT department to spend a fair bit of time and energy ensuring that data is correctly backed up and stored, server images maintained against SOE, and that all the DR documentation is up to date. Also, unfortunately, sometimes IT departments themselves contribute unintentionally to disruptions, such as storing tapes near electromagnetic equipment, or failing to refuel backup generators, or even housing the IT department in the basement in a cyclone zone. And that last one I can say from my own bitter experience. And let's face it, it's often difficult enough just keeping your production systems running to meet the ever-increasing demands from the business, let alone keeping the backup infrastructure as well up to scratch. And this is why I think prevention for business continuity is better than reaction for disaster recovery, which is why many organisations are now implementing programs for business continuity instead of disaster recovery. And I think that's because business continuity aims to maintain operations in the event of a disruption. And it also becomes a whole organisational wide process, with IT as a stakeholder rather than being the person who's expected to carry the entire responsibility. Disaster recovery just becomes an element in a wider business continuity plan. And business continuity also means that rather than backing up data, you're really replicating it as close to real time as possible so that it can be switched on as quickly as possible. You know, ideas of like, you know, RPO, the restore point objective, and RTO, the restore time objective, really become meaningless because what you're aiming to do is actually keep things running. The problem we've got is that because of the investment required to ensure continuity, not all areas of a business can be included. Now, one of the first elements of a business continuity plan is to identify those priority areas that must be maintained and running at all times. However, a business continuity plan shouldn't just concentrate on keeping the infrastructure on its own running, because it's pointless if the disaster prevents your users from accessing that infrastructure. A comprehensive business continuity plan enables access for users from non-standard locations, such as from home or from temporary remote offices. And the idea of who actually constitutes a user needs to be re-evaluated. For many organisations, users are no longer just your employees, but can also include those of your customers who transact with you online, your vendors and other business partners that access your systems via portals or server connections. Even prospective customers who come to you via your website need to be taken into consideration. So with that in mind, let me hand you over to Alex, who can take you through a real-world scenario.
Thank you, James. A couple of years ago, I was talking to an organisation that were in the broken arena. They were based up in the northern part of Sydney, and what they did, they had a number of brokers on the line, but they also had an online system that enabled trading to happen. Now, I'd been speaking to them on and off for 2-3 years, evaluating the risks of how they managed their infrastructure, and what they had is they had all of that core infrastructure locally within their primary office. That was all of their systems. They had virtualized it to address some of the availability there, but they hadn't yet seen the requirement of moving that out of their internal office. So in that office that they were in, it was they were on one floor and there were other tenants on other floors, but they had access to a building generator. There was just a single one of those. And in their comms room, they installed their own UPSs, and that was there, and they'd identified that would need to support them 4 hours, because they couldn't really think of a scenario that could happen which would take them off air without the building generator or the UPS not working. And the way that they did that, that was against the RPOs and the RTOs that they'd set for their organisation that they'd worked through. And they looked at that as IT as a whole practice when they did that as well. But then what happened, as many of you are probably familiar with, we had a power outage not so long ago in Sydney, and that took out the northern area for quite a number of hours, and in some cases actually longer than that. So the business failed over onto their UPS, as they hoped, and that took up power and that started working. But one of the things they did start to see is actually they'd forgot to factor in that they'd installed quite a bit more infrastructure into their comms room. And so the UPS, when they initially scoped that, that would have supported 4 hours of power, but now it was draining through at twice the rate. They were facing a little bit of a challenge around that area. And then they eventually did run out of power, and that was when they'd hoped that the building generator would have been up to speed. But one of the other things that happened whilst this was going on was the building generator hadn't actually kicked in. And so that wasn't supplying any power to their floor. Now, it worked on a couple of the other floors, but it just so happened that it didn't kick in through some reason onto their floor where their comms room was. So then suddenly the infrastructure powered down. And then suddenly the CIO's mobile started to ring a lot, because all of the brokers were phoning through to say, what's going on? I can't get hold of anyone and I can't process this trade through our systems. And that then presented them with a big issue. It actually took them quite a while to come back on, and they had to source some further UPSs from an external party. And because of what happened, obviously the cost of procuring those at that time went through the roof, because everybody was looking to get what they could and get their hands on what they could just in case. But they managed to survive. It hurt them in a big way, but they did manage to survive. What the outcome of that was that they revisited the whole BCP, and they went through that in a lot more detail than what they had previously. Some of the things they identified out of that incident about what they could have done is they could have looked at getting their own separate generator put within the building. But then the cost of putting their own generator was six figures. It was around $200,000 to get that put in, and then they needed to hire the floor space for that and reach agreement with the building management company, and that just wasn't going to happen. They then looked at getting some more UPS, and they'd actually had those ones that they procured, but then the maintenance of those and to actually get what they needed to do, and when they weighed through supporting that, the UPS wasn't going to be the right route either. Third option that they did look into and what they did consider was the replication of the infrastructure to another office, but that brought with it some of the own challenges. I mean, what they did see when the incident happened is that the processes that they had around that event just didn't work as smoothly as they thought, because the people were being pulled left, right and centre. So they needed to put something in place that kind of minimised the person management in the process and, you know, automated wherever they could. So that's where we re-engaged with the client, and we spoke through their new revised set of RTOs and RPOs, and, you know, this was based around the application sets around the different areas of the business and what they were supporting and what that meant to the business in terms of mission critical, business critical, and then sustainable. And the solution that we worked through with them, we scoped and we moved their production environment to the IntelliCenter. That was initially to address the power redundancy requirements. As you're probably aware, the IntelliCenter sits on three different power grids, as well as having multiple generators and those vast arrays of batteries that are there. Secondly, it also addressed the network component. So it provided them with a multi-carrier model with backup in depth around that, so we could make sure that should something happen, a similar event around network cables being cut, that we could continue to deliver services to them and that their brokers' trades were not interrupted and they could continue to run as a business. And that was the first thing, and we moved that project quite quickly and we put that in place. What we also did was we put that on a managed platform rather than a self-managed solution, and that was because they recognised that their key people were so busy with the systems that they couldn't then afford the time to actually implement the processes that were around that. And that's what we put in at day one. Then 6 months later, what we're now in the process of rolling out for that organization is the continuation of the exercise. They're addressing further risks that they had in their BCP. And this is actually to put in place a secondary site with a scaled down environment that they can run their production from at a slightly different level of performance, but it would still enable them to trade the transactions that they need to do to maintain uptime to the business.
Thanks for that, Alex. What I'd like to do now is hand you over to Dale Wilson, who'll take you through the range of disaster recovery and business continuity technologies that are around today.
There is usually four different options that a company could consider in terms of disaster recovery, sort of ranging from your old-style basic tape backup right through to dual data center design. So I'll talk through those options and give you the pros and cons of each type. Firstly, you know, the old-fashioned tape backup. It's been around, you know, Nazi invented this in the 1940s, the old tapes, very old technology, but it's reliable, it seems to work, and it has been, you know, going for a long, long time. So your off-site tape backup is obviously the first DR option that a company considers. The good points to it are that it's usually very cheap, and it is a proven technology, and your data does actually live in another site, which is generally run by some type of data recovery tape backup service is involved, where you've got a third party that actually use a courier to receive and take your tapes and restore your tapes. So it is a proven service. The drawbacks to this type of service, however, are very much around the time to recover. So these days, the tape backup technology is reaching its sort of peak efficiencies in terms of how much data can be stored on a tape, which is your current generation of LTO4 tapes. And those types of tapes can take up to about 12 hours to recover a terabyte. So as an organization, their amount of volume of critical data grows, we're generally looking at most companies having between 4 to 6 terabytes of critical data. So you're potentially looking at least 3 days just to recover that data. And that's on top of any outage time that has already occurred. So that's tape backup. Second one is kind of similar technology, but it just removes the tapes. It's called disk-to-disk backup. This is where you've got your dedupe products that are on the market today, where basically the data is captured and stored onto a remote SAN or NAS, and it's just basically stored off-site on another disk. So concept is the same. It doesn't have the technology limitations of tapes as such, because as we know, disk is very cheap and, you know, you can just get as much SAN space as you generally need. However, it does do is it shifts the issue from having to restore the data off a tape. You're now relying on the network infrastructure to get the data back. There is no tape concept. It's just sitting on a remote SAN somewhere. So if you can't get your comms back up, you can't get your data back. And that's also fairly cheap. The next one up the stack is what we would call a site-to-data center replication. So what that means is where you might have your production facilities are in some data center where you've got, you know, necessary infrastructure, and you're using your own site where your office is as a backup. Now, the benefit of doing this is that you have two independent sort of server farms. So if the data center goes down, you can fail over to your site without too much hassle. The cost is a lot more than the first two options, obviously, because you're running two sites and two technology stacks. However, the time to recover now is generally down to about 4 hours. This type of design is suited very much towards companies that have either already geared up internally with a very good comms facility and want to use that investment, or a company that has a lot of server infrastructure already, don't want to waste that investment. The last option here is where it's DC to DC replication and failover, where it's basically two different data centers, both with, you know, server farms and infrastructure at both locations, and you've got SAN-to-SAN replication. Now, this is obviously the best technical solution, but it's also the most expensive. This is very much geared for companies who have services where they just cannot go down. If you need to have a website or some type of application that can't go down no matter what, this is the type of design which is best suited towards you. So this includes the replication of the data and includes, you know, network and comms failover between data centers, and all the necessary applications are installed twice at each location.
Thank you, Dale. So if you haven't actually completed a disaster recovery or a business continuity plan, I'd recommend the following steps. First, if you don't have a program for business continuity, create the business case for one. There are tools out there that will help you build a justification, but one simple yet powerful method is just to ask your CFO to estimate what the cost of the business would be if your line of business applications were down for a day, or how about 10 days? Next, identify what those must-stay running mission-critical applications and infrastructure elements are. Most companies will automatically concentrate on their CRM or ERP systems, but could your business survive without email? What about the plain old telephone service? Don't forget to include which users from which locations should be included in your business continuity plan. Finally, let the experts help you manage your business continuity infrastructure. Macquarie Telecom has been providing managed DR services for almost a decade now, and our IntelliCentre is the most certified in Australia. With ISO 27001, ASIO T4, and even the BC-specific AS4360, as just some of our many certifications. Some of our DR solutions come with guarantees that are financially backed. This frees you from having to concentrate on keeping your DR infrastructure up to date, allowing you to focus on transitioning to business continuity. Thank you, and we'll open up for questions shortly.